In a peaceful suburb, a veteran officer makes a routine call that shatters lives in unexpected ways. When he wrongfully detains two teenage boys based on nothing but a vague description, he thinks the story ends there. But just days later, those same boys step into danger to protect someone he loves most, his own son. The twist? These teens have more courage and integrity than anyone could have imagined, forcing the officer to confront not just his own prejudices, but the deep flaws in the system he thought he understood. As threats escalate and hidden truths emerge, alliances are tested, and the stakes climb higher than anyone expected. What happens when the ones you wrongfully judge become the ones who save you? And can redemption ever come without a cost? Before we get into the story, comment below where in the world you are watching from today. Officer Thomas Langley savored the last sip of his morning coffee, watching the sun's rays filter through the oak trees that lined Springvale's pristine streets. The familiar weight of his badge pressed against his chest as he observed the quiet neighborhood through his windshield. A jogger in expensive athletic wear waved as she passed, and he nodded in response. The squad car's radio hummed softly, a constant companion during his morning patrols. He reached for his notepad, reviewing the day's minor incidents with practiced efficiency. "Mrs. Peterson's complaint about the construction noise," he muttered, shaking his head with a slight smile. The wealthy residents of Springvale were particular about their peace and quiet. The tranquility shattered like glass when a piercing alarm cut through the morning air. Langley's body tensed, coffee forgotten as he immediately recognized the source, the Harper estate, just two blocks away. The alarm's wail echoed off the perfectly maintained colonial-style homes. Langley grabbed his radio, his movements swift and precise. "Dispatch, this is Officer Langley, reporting an active alarm at 1242 Maple Drive, the Harper residence." The radio crackled. "Copy that, Officer Langley, confirming security alarm triggered at the Harper residence." Before he could respond, another call came through. "Dispatch to Officer Langley. We have a report from a neighbor. Two young males observed entering the Harper property through the side gate. Suspects wearing hooded sweatshirts. No further description available." Langley's heart rate quickened as he assessed the situation. The Harper estate was known for its state-of-the-art security system, not the kind of target amateur burglars would typically choose. He keyed his radio again. "Copy that, dispatch. Requesting backup to my location." The morning sun suddenly felt less warm as Langley started his patrol car. The engine purred to life, and he pulled away from his regular spot by the park. As he navigated the winding streets, lined with their perfect rows of mature trees and expertly landscaped gardens, the alarm's persistent wail grew louder. The Harper estate came into view, a massive Georgian-style mansion set back from the road behind ornate wrought iron gates. The property's tall hedges created natural walls, perfect for concealing intruders. The alarm's screech seemed to intensify as Langley approached, its urgent cry breaking through the neighborhood's usual peaceful atmosphere. His trained eyes scanned the perimeter as he slowed the patrol car, taking in every detail. The side gate the neighbor mentioned was partially hidden behind a row of carefully trimmed boxwoods. Langley's fingers tightened on the steering wheel as he assessed his approach, years of experience guiding his tactical thinking. Officer Langley pulled up to the Harper estate, the patrol car's tires crunching softly on the pristine asphalt. The alarm's wail pierced through the morning air, bouncing off neighboring houses. He parked just outside the ornate wrought iron gates, leaving the engine running as protocol demanded. Through the decorative metalwork, he studied the sprawling property. Manicured hedges lined the curved driveway, and morning dew still clung to the perfectly trimmed lawn. Nothing seemed immediately disturbed, no obvious signs of forced entry or damage. His radio crackled to life. "Officer Langley, be advised, original caller report suspects fled the scene on foot moments after entering the property. No additional witnesses at this time." "Copy that," Langley responded, his eyes still scanning the grounds. The side gate stood closed, its latch appearing undisturbed. Something didn't add up. Making a quick decision, Langley shifted his car into drive. He'd sweep the surrounding streets. Suspects on foot couldn't have gotten far. The patrol car rolled slowly through the neighborhood as Langley methodically checked each street and alley. Three blocks away, movement caught his eye. Two figures in hooded sweatshirts walked along the sidewalk at a steady pace. They matched the vague description perfectly. Langley's pulse quickened as he reached for his radio. "Dispatch, this is Langley. I have visual on two individuals matching the description, heading east on Cedar Street." His voice remained steady despite the surge of adrenaline coursing through him. "Copy that, Officer Langley." He followed at a distance, observing their movements. The two figures maintained a brisk but unhurried pace, hands visible at their sides. Langley had handled countless similar situations over his years on the force, but something about this one made him uneasy. Pulling his patrol car to the curb, Langley stepped out. The morning air felt cooler now, and the distant alarm had finally fallen silent. His right hand settled naturally near his holstered weapon as he watched the two figures continue down the sidewalk. Their hooded sweatshirts obscured their faces from his position, but their movements seemed casual, unbothered. Drawing himself up to his full height, Langley called out with practiced authority, "Excuse me, police officer, I need to speak with you both for a moment." As Langley drew closer to the two figures, the morning light revealed them to be teenage boys, perhaps 16 or 17 years old. Their matching hooded sweatshirts weren't the only thing identical about them. Their faces bore the same features, down to the curve of their jawlines. Twins, Langley realized, his suspicion deepening. "Stop right there and turn around," Langley commanded, his voice carrying across the quiet street. The boys halted, exchanging quick, worried glances before slowly turning to face him. Their movements were hesitant, careful. "What are you doing in this neighborhood?" Langley demanded, his eyes darting between them. His right hand remained close to his weapon, though not directly on it. The slightly taller boy spoke first, his voice steady despite the tension. "We're walking home from our friend's house, sir. We live just a few blocks away." "Which friend? What's the address?" Langley cut in, not bothering to hide his skepticism. "Jason Chen on Maple Street," the same boy answered. "I'm Matt Taylor and this is my brother Malcolm. We didn't do anything wrong." Malcolm shifted his weight from foot to foot, his hands fidgeting with the hem of his sweatshirt. The nervous movement only heightened Langley's suspicion. "Stand still," Langley ordered, his tone sharp. "We've had reports of a break-in, and you two match the description of our suspects perfectly." "Break-in?" Matt's eyebrows rose. "That's impossible. We've been at Jason's all morning, practicing for the school concert. You can call him..." "Put your hands where I can see them," Langley interrupted, reaching for his radio. "Dispatch, this is Langley. I need backup at Cedar and Oak. I have two suspects detained." Malcolm's breath hitched audibly, and even Matt's composure cracked slightly. "Sir, please," Matt tried again, keeping his hands visible but his voice firm. "This is a mistake. We're students at Springvale High." "I said be quiet," Langley snapped, moving closer. "Both of you, hands behind your backs. You're being detained for questioning." "This isn't right," Matt protested, though he slowly complied. "We haven't done anything wrong. You can't just..." "I can and I am," Langley stated, pulling out his handcuffs. The metal clinked ominously in the morning air. Malcolm's hands trembled as Langley secured the cuffs around his wrists, while Matt's jaw clenched tightly, his eyes bright with indignation. In the distance, sirens began to wail. Langley maintained his grip on both boys' shoulders, feeling justified as the sound grew louder. Matt and Malcolm stood in rigid silence, their expressions a mixture of fear and barely contained anger as they waited for the backup to arrive. The morning sun beat down on the quiet suburban street as Langley stood beside his patrol car, arms crossed, watching the Taylor twins. Matt sat perfectly still on the curb, his back straight despite his cuffed hands. His steady gaze never wavered from Langley's face, carrying a quiet intensity that made the officer's skin prickle with discomfort. Malcolm, hunched beside his brother, kept glancing around nervously. His lips moved in constant motion, forming words too soft to hear. The whispered sounds carried on the breeze like fallen leaves, just out of reach.
"Yeah,
want to tell me what you were really doing in this neighborhood?" Langley demanded, trying to mask his unease with authority. Matt didn't respond. His unwavering stare felt like an accusation, making Langley shift his weight from one foot to the other. The silence stretched between them, broken only by Malcolm's continued murmuring. "Speak up, boy," Langley snapped at Malcolm. "What are you saying?" Malcolm's whispers grew slightly louder, though still unclear. The cadence of his voice had an odd rhythm to it, almost like a chant or prayer. Something about it made the hair on the back of Langley's neck stand up. The welcome sound of approaching sirens cut through the tension. Two patrol cars pulled up, their lights flashing against the neat suburban houses. Officers Johnson and Rivera stepped out, followed by Officer Chen. "What have we got?" Johnson asked, approaching Langley. "Two suspects matching the description from the Harper break-in," Langley reported, grateful for the backup. "Found them walking a few blocks from the scene. The quiet one won't talk, and the other one..." He gestured toward Malcolm, who continued his unsettling whispers. The officers gathered around Langley as he explained the situation, but he found his attention repeatedly drawn back to the twins. Matt's unflinching gaze seemed to bore right through him, while Malcolm's muttering had taken on an almost melodic quality that seemed to hang in the air like mist. Officers Johnson and Rivera moved to help the boys up, preparing to transport them to the station. As they guided Matt and Malcolm toward the waiting patrol car, Langley couldn't shake the growing discomfort in his chest. Malcolm's whispered words seemed to echo in his mind, though he still couldn't make them out. The morning air felt heavier somehow, charged with something he couldn't explain. The late afternoon sun stretched shadows across the quiet suburban street as Langley secured the handcuffs around Malcolm's wrists, then Matt's. The metal clicked into place with a finality that echoed in the still air. Both boys remained silent, their faces masks of contained emotion that made Langley's stomach churn with an inexplicable unease. He reached for his radio, ready to call for transport, when it suddenly crackled to life. Officer Martinez's voice cut through the static, urgent and clear. "We've got the real suspect," Martinez reported from the Harper estate. "Security footage shows a man scaling the fence. He's wearing dark clothing, no hoodie. I'm bringing him in now." Langley's hand froze on the radio. The words hit him like a physical blow, making his chest tighten and his throat go dry. The description bore no resemblance to the two teenagers he'd just handcuffed. His mind struggled to process the magnitude of his error as the reality of the situation crashed over him. Turning slowly, he faced the twins again. Matt sat perfectly straight on the curb, his eyes boring into Langley with that same unwavering stare that had unsettled him earlier. Malcolm kept his gaze fixed on his cuffed hands, but there was something different in his expression now, a slight bitter curve to his lips that spoke volumes. The backup officers shifted uncomfortably behind him. Langley could feel their eyes on his back, sense their growing awareness that something had gone terribly wrong. The weight of their presence only amplified the crushing pressure in his chest. Breaking the heavy silence, Langley lifted his radio again. His voice sounded strange and distant to his own ears as he reported to dispatch. "Be advised. Subjects detained at my location do not match suspect description. Proceeding with immediate release." The keys jingled loudly in his pocket as he pulled them out, each step toward the twins feeling heavier than the last. The knot in his stomach grew tighter as he approached them, the gravity of his mistake pressing down on him like a physical weight. Matt's steady gaze never wavered as Langley bent to unlock his cuffs. Malcolm continued to stare downward, mumbling words too quiet to hear, his bitter smile still playing at the corners of his mouth. The metal bracelets fell away with a soft clink that seemed to echo in the tense silence. Langley stood rooted to the spot, watching the twins' retreating forms. His throat felt tight, constricted by guilt and shame. "Wait," he called out, his voice wavering. "I'm sorry." The twins stopped but remained still for several long seconds. When they finally turned around, Matt's expression was composed but resolute. He took a deliberate step forward, his gaze fixed on Langley. "You assumed we were guilty, didn't you?" Matt's words cut through the evening air with precise clarity. "Just like everyone else." Behind him, Malcolm crossed his arms tightly across his chest, his face a canvas of barely contained emotion. Langley opened his mouth to respond, but no words came. In all his years on the force, he'd never felt so thoroughly disarmed. His badge and uniform, usually a source of confidence and authority, now felt like a crushing weight. "This isn't the first time," Matt continued, his voice steady but laden with years of accumulated pain. "We're used to it by now. People like you, deciding who we are before we even open our mouths." The words hit Langley like physical blows. He looked at the boys, really looked at them, and saw beyond their hoodies and their youth. He saw two teenagers who had probably endured countless similar encounters, who had learned to expect judgment before understanding. His mind flickered through memories of other stops, other arrests, other assumptions he'd made without questioning. Malcolm remained silent behind his brother, but his eyes spoke volumes. They held a mixture of hurt, resignation, and something else, a silent accusation that seemed to pierce right through Langley's practiced professional demeanor. Standing there in the fading daylight, Langley felt the full weight of his actions pressing down on him. Every training session, every protocol he'd followed, every time he'd convinced himself he was just doing his job, it all seemed hollow now, exposed by the quiet dignity of Matt's words and the painful truth they carried. The gravity of the situation settled over him like a heavy blanket. He wasn't just facing the consequences of a single mistake. He was confronting a pattern, a system he'd been part of without questioning. The realization made his stomach churn and his chest tighten with a new kind of understanding. After the encounter with the twins, Langley drove through Springvale's winding streets without direction, his mind replaying Matt's steady, accusing gaze. Finally, he pulled into an empty parking lot and sat there, the engine idling. With trembling hands, he pulled out his phone and typed, "Taylor Twins Springvale," into the search bar. The results made his stomach clench. A local news article from just months ago showed Matt and Malcolm seated at instruments, Matt at a gleaming piano, Malcolm with a violin tucked under his chin. The headline praised their musical achievements and academic excellence. Both were honor students at Springvale High, with perfect GPAs and numerous awards. The article detailed their volunteer work at a local youth music program and their upcoming performance at a prestigious concert hall. Langley's throat tightened as he scrolled through more articles. The twins weren't just good students, they were exceptional, leaders in their community. The kind of teenagers parents hoped their kids would become. The next morning, Langley stood on the porch of the Taylor home, his palms sweaty. It was a modest house, but well-maintained, with neat flower beds and freshly painted trim. He rang the doorbell, his heart pounding. Matt opened the door, his expression hardening when he recognized Langley. Malcolm appeared beside his brother, and behind them stood a woman Langley assumed was their mother, her face a careful mask of politeness tinged with wariness. "I..." Langley started, his rehearsed speech crumbling. "I came to apologize. I was wrong. I made assumptions that were unfair and biased. I saw the article about your music, your achievements. I should have..." "An apology doesn't undo what happened," Malcolm cut in, his voice tight with emotion. "It doesn't erase how we felt when you cuffed us like criminals." His hands clenched at his sides, and for the first time, Langley heard the full force of his pain. Langley opened his mouth, then closed it again. What could he possibly say? The words felt hollow, inadequate against the weight of what he'd done. Mrs. Taylor's hand rested protectively on Malcolm's shoulder as Matt stood silent, arms crossed, his gaze as steady and condemning as it had been the day before. The door closed with a quiet click, leaving Langley alone on the porch. He walked back to his car in a daze, each step feeling heavier than the last. Sliding into the driver's seat, he gripped the steering wheel and stared straight ahead, the weight of his failure pressing down on him like a physical thing. At his desk in the precinct, Langley stared blankly at the stack of paperwork before him. The fluorescent lights hummed overhead, but he barely noticed. His mind kept returning to the Taylor twins, their steady gazes, their quiet dignity in the face of his accusations. With a deep breath, he turned to his computer and pulled up their records again. This time, he dug deeper. Teacher recommendations practically glowed with praise. "Matt shows exceptional leadership qualities," one read. "Malcolm's sensitivity to others makes him a natural mentor," said another. A local news website showed videos of their performances. Langley clicked on one, keeping the volume low. Malcolm's violin sang with emotion while Matt's fingers danced across piano keys. The music was beautiful, complex, far beyond what Langley had expected from high school students. The comments section overflowed with community support. "These boys are treasures, and so proud to have them representing Springvale." Each new discovery felt like a punch to the gut. He'd nearly arrested two of the community's brightest stars based on nothing but prejudice. Leaning back in his chair, Langley's gaze drifted across the busy precinct. How many times had he heard colleagues make snap judgments? How often had he stayed silent, telling himself it wasn't his problem? He remembered dismissed complaints, ignored concerns, casual comments that revealed deep-seated biases. Opening a new document, Langley began typing his internal report. He detailed the incident with brutal honesty, laying bare his assumptions and their consequences. Under recommendations, he wrote firmly, "Mandatory bias training for all officers, regular community engagement programs, review of current procedures for suspect identification and detention." It felt small compared to the scope of the problem, but it was something concrete, something he could actually do. Around him, the precinct bustled with activity. Officers filed reports, answered calls, went about their daily routines. But for the first time in his career, Langley saw it all differently. His badge caught the overhead light, drawing his attention. He touched it briefly, feeling its weight, not just as a symbol of authority, but as a reminder of the tremendous responsibility he carried to do better, to be better, to make real change. Langley pulled into the visitor parking space at Westwood High School, his police cruiser looking out of place among the scattered student vehicles. The brick building loomed before him, its windows reflecting the afternoon sun. Inside the main office, he found himself surrounded by the typical trappings of high school success, gleaming trophies in glass cases, student artwork brightening the walls, honor roll lists prominently displayed. Ms. Carter emerged from her office to greet him, her professional demeanor masking any immediate reaction to seeing a police officer in her school. She was well-dressed and carried herself with quiet authority, her sharp eyes taking his measure as he introduced himself. "Officer Langley," she said, gesturing toward her office, "please come in." Her office was a testament to student achievement. Photos of graduating classes and academic ceremonies covered one wall, while framed diplomas and certificates occupied another. She settled behind her desk, folding her hands as Langley explained his presence. "The Taylor twins," she said softly when he finished. "I wondered if someone would come asking about them." She paused, collecting her thoughts. "Their story isn't a simple one." Ms. Carter's voice grew gentle as she shared their history. "Their grandmother took them in when they were very young, after their parents passed. Money was always tight, but she made sure they never missed school, never went without the basics. Those boys learned early that nothing would be handed to them." Langley sat quietly, absorbing every detail as Ms. Carter continued. "Despite everything, they've maintained perfect GPAs. Malcolm's violin playing has won state competitions, and Matt's piano compositions have been performed by our advanced orchestra. But what truly sets them apart is their character." She leaned forward, her expression earnest. "Last year there was a freshman being bullied, a boy with a disability. Matt and Malcolm stepped in, not just once, but every time they saw it happening. They've tutored struggling students, organized fundraisers for families in need. They've faced more prejudice than I care to count, but they've never let it harden their hearts." Langley's throat felt tight as Ms. Carter described incident after incident where the twins had shown exceptional integrity. "They've had to grow up fast," she said, sadness creeping into her voice. "They've faced more prejudice than anyone their age should have to, but they've never let it make them bitter. If anything, they're the first to stand up for others, even if it costs them." As Ms. Carter spoke, Langley's guilt deepened. These weren't troublemakers or criminals. They were young men who had overcome tremendous odds to become pillars of their school community. His assumptions about them felt even more shameful in light of their actual character. He left the school with Ms. Carter's words echoing in his mind, the weight of his prejudice pressing down on him more heavily than ever. The twins' faces, dignified and resilient in the face of his accusations, haunted his thoughts as he walked back to his cruiser, more determined than ever to make meaningful change. Langley sat at his kitchen table, mechanically finishing the last bites of his dinner. The house was quiet, except for the gentle hum of the dishwasher and the ticking of the wall clock. He noticed movement in the doorway and looked up to see his son Caleb hovering uncertainly, his small hands twisting the hem of his t-shirt. Dad, I need to tell you something, Caleb said, his voice wavering. The tremor in his voice made Langley immediately set down his fork, giving his son his complete attention. Caleb shuffled closer to the table, his eyes downcast. There are these boys at the park, he began, his words coming out haltingly. They make fun of the way I talk. His stutter became more pronounced as he grew more upset. Langley's heart clenched as Caleb continued, describing how a group of older boys had taken to mocking him whenever he tried to play at the park. They would mimic his stutter, laugh when he struggled with certain words, and make cruel jokes about his speech impediment. I tried to stand up to them, Caleb said, tears welling in his eyes. I told them to stop, just like you taught me. But they just laughed harder. A tear rolled down his cheek as he described the most recent incident, where the boys had followed him around the playground, taking turns imitating his stutter until he'd finally run home. Langley felt a surge of protective anger rise in his chest, his hands clenched into fists under the table, but he forced himself to remain outwardly calm for Caleb's sake. The thought of his son enduring such cruelty made his blood boil. Listen to me, buddy, Langley said, reaching out to place a gentle hand on Caleb's shoulder. Next time we go to the park, I'm coming with you. Those boys won't get away with this anymore. I promise. Caleb managed a small, grateful smile, though his eyes were still wet with tears. Langley pulled him into a tight hug, but internally, he couldn't shake the gnawing guilt. How had he missed the signs? How long had his son been suffering in silence? That evening, Langley tucked Caleb into bed, smoothing the covers around him with extra care. Things will be different now, he promised, switching on Caleb's favorite nightlight. As he closed his son's bedroom door, a fierce determination settled over him. Langley's pen scratched across yet another form, the stack of paperwork on his desk seeming endless. The precinct hummed with the usual evening activity, phones ringing, officers chatting, keyboards clicking. He rubbed his tired eyes, reaching for his lukewarm coffee. A glance at the clock stopped him mid-motion. 6:45 p.m. His heart lurched. No, 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 he muttered, jumping up from his desk. He was supposed to pick up Caleb from the park 45 minutes ago. Papers scattered as he grabbed his keys, barely remembering to snatch his jacket from the back of his chair. Everything okay? Officer Martinez called as Langley rushed past. Late for Caleb, he managed, pushing through the precinct doors. The evening air hit his face as he sprinted to his car, his mind racing with possibilities. Had Caleb tried walking home alone? Were those bullies still there? The drive felt endless. Langley's knuckles whitened on the steering wheel as streetlights flickered to life around him. Each red light felt like torture as scenarios played through his head. Caleb alone, scared, being taunted by those cruel kids. Finally, the park came into view. Langley's headlights swept across the entrance as he pulled into the parking lot. His heart nearly stopped when he spotted three figures by the gate. Caleb stood there, his small frame trembling, head bowed. But he wasn't alone. On either side of him stood Matt and Malcolm Taylor, their identical faces illuminated by the street lamp above. The same boys he'd wrongly arrested just days ago were now standing with his son. Anger and confusion surged through Langley as he threw the car into park. His protective instincts flared, assuming the worst. Had the twins been harassing Caleb? Was this some kind of revenge? He yanked his door open, his boots hitting the pavement with purpose. The twins noticed his approach first, their expressions unreadable in the dim light. Caleb remained hunched, his shoulders shaking slightly. Langley strode toward them, his jaw clenched and fists tight at his sides. The distance between his car and the park entrance had never felt longer, each step fueled by a father's protective rage. Langley's footsteps thundered against the pavement as he approached the group, his finger jabbing through the air. What do you think you're doing? He demanded, his voice echoing across the empty park. The accusation hung heavy in the evening air as Caleb visibly flinched, tears rolling down his cheeks. Matt stepped forward with measured calm, his hands raised in a peaceful gesture. His voice remained steady, despite Langley's hostile approach. Officer Langley, you've got it wrong. Before Matt could continue, Caleb's voice burst out, cracking with emotion. Dad, stop, they're helping me. The words hit Langley like a physical force, stopping him in his tracks. His eyes darted between his son's tear-streaked face and the twins' composed expressions, his anger giving way to confusion. Through hitching breaths and sobs, Caleb explained how the usual group of bullies had surrounded him near the playground. They'd been taunting him about his stutter, making cruel imitations of his speech. But then Matt and Malcolm had appeared, stepping between Caleb and his tormentors. The twins hadn't hesitated to stand up to the older boys, firmly telling them to leave and not come back. As Caleb spoke, Langley felt his anger dissolving, replaced by a familiar shame that seemed to weigh heavier with each passing moment. The twins remained where they stood, their presence steady and dignified despite his baseless accusation. Matt spoke again, his voice gentle but firm. "We didn't want to leave him alone like that. No kid should have to deal with bullies." Beside him, Malcolm nodded, his typically guarded expression softening as he looked at Caleb. Langley's shoulders slumped as he lowered his head, his voice barely above a whisper. "I'm sorry. Again." The words felt inadequate, yet they were all he could manage. The twins shared a brief look before Matt responded simply, "Just make sure Caleb is safe." Langley knelt beside his son, pulling him into a tight embrace as they watched the Taylor twins walk away, their figures gradually fading into the gathering dusk. Langley crouched down beside Caleb, placing a gentle hand on his shoulder. His son's face was still wet with tears as he wrapped his arms tightly around his father. Over Caleb's shoulder, Langley caught sight of Matt and Malcolm, who stood quietly nearby, their expressions a blend of patience and resolve. Caleb pulled back slightly, wiping his eyes with the sleeve of his jacket. He turned toward the twins, his voice shaky but determined. "Dad, these are Matt and Malcolm. They saved me." Taking a deep breath, Caleb began to describe what had happened. The usual group of boys had approached him near the playground, their familiar taunts echoing across the park. They'd circled around him, mimicking his stutter and calling him names. When Caleb tried to walk away, they blocked his path, their voices growing meaner. "They were going to hit me," Caleb's voice cracked as he spoke, his hands twisting the hem of his shirt. "But then Matt and Malcolm showed up." The twins had been passing by when they noticed the confrontation. Without hesitation, they stepped between Caleb and the bullies, their presence commanding enough to make the group pause. Despite being outnumbered, Matt and Malcolm stood firm, their unified front causing the bullies to back down and eventually scatter. "They asked if I wanted them to walk me home," Caleb continued, his voice growing stronger. "When I said you were coming to get me, they said they'd wait to make sure I was okay." Langley looked up at the twins, his chest tight with conflicting emotions. He opened his mouth to speak but found himself at a loss for words. The weight of their kindness, especially after how he had treated them, left him speechless. Caleb, now calmer, offered a small smile. "They're really cool, Dad," he said softly, breaking the heavy silence. Langley nodded, his voice barely above a whisper. "Yeah, they are." Langley rose to his feet, his hands hanging awkwardly at his sides as he faced Matt and Malcolm. The twins shared a quick glance, recognition flickering across their faces. The calm composure they'd shown while protecting Caleb wavered as understanding dawned. This was the same officer who had detained them days before, and Caleb was his son. Matt took a small step backward, his expression carefully controlled, while Malcolm shifted his weight from foot to foot, casting quick glances toward the park exit. The evening air grew thick with tension. "Wait," Langley said quickly, raising his hands in a peaceful gesture. "Please don't go." The twins paused, their faces unreadable in the fading light. Langley drew in a deep breath, his voice dropping to a sincere, quiet tone. "I know I've apologized before, but I need to say it again. I misjudged you, twice now, and both times, you've proven me wrong." He glanced down at Caleb, then back to the twins. "I can't tell you how much it means to me that you stood up for Caleb. Thank you." Matt crossed his arms over his chest, his stance protective, but it was Malcolm who broke the silence. "We didn't do it for you," he said softly, meeting Langley's gaze without flinching. "We did it because it was the right thing to do." Langley nodded, emotion tightening his throat. I know, he managed. That's what makes you better than me. The heavy atmosphere began to lift as Matt finally spoke. We're just glad he's okay, he said, nodding toward Caleb. Langley extended his hand for a shake, but Matt simply gave a small nod of acknowledgement. The twins turned and walked away, their figures growing dimmer in the evening light. Langley remained standing with Caleb at his side, watching them go. Langley paced his living room, running his hand through his hair as he rehearsed what he would say. The evening light cast long shadows across the carpet while his wife Sarah watched from the couch, concern etched on her face. Maybe you should let it go, she suggested gently. They've been through enough. Langley shook his head. I can't. Not after what they did for Caleb. He picked up his phone, his fingers hovering over the keypad. I need to do something more. Taking a deep breath, he dialed the Taylor residence. Mrs. Taylor answered, her voice cautious but polite. Langley introduced himself, stumbling slightly over his words. I wanted to invite Matt and Malcolm over for dinner, he explained, as a thank you for helping my son and, well, as an apology for my actions. There was a long pause on the line. He could hear muffled voices as Mrs. Taylor consulted with her sons. When she returned, her tone was gentle but firm. We appreciate the gesture, Officer Langley, but the boys don't feel comfortable with that right now. The incident at the park, it's still fresh. Langley's shoulders slumped. I understand, he said quietly. Later that night, Langley sat in his home office, surrounded by the soft glow of his laptop screen. His police badge lay on the desk beside him, catching the light and drawing his attention. He typed, "Implicit bias in law enforcement" into the search bar, then paused. Memories flooded back. Times he'd ignored questionable comments from fellow officers, instances where he'd made snap judgments based on appearance. Each recollection felt like a weight pressing down on his conscience. Sarah appeared in the doorway, wrapped in her robe. Tom, it's late, she said softly. What are you doing? Research, he replied, scrolling through an article about diversity training. I need to understand better. She leaned against the doorframe. You really think you can change things? The system is bigger than just you. Langley met her skeptical gaze. Maybe, but I have to try. He turned back to his laptop, opening another tab about systemic reforms in policing, his determination growing stronger with each article he read. The morning sun filtered through Langley's kitchen windows as he sipped his coffee, reviewing case files spread across the table. The doorbell's sudden chime startled him from his concentration. Opening the front door, he found Ms. Carter standing on his porch, her usually composed demeanor marked by visible concern. Officer Langley, I apologize for coming unannounced, she said, clutching her purse tightly. But this couldn't wait. Langley invited her inside, noting the tension in her shoulders as she settled into a chair at his kitchen table. She wasted no time getting to the point. The twins have been receiving threats, she said, her voice tight with worry. Anonymous notes in their lockers, messages online. It started after the incident at the park with your son. Langley's stomach dropped. Ms. Carter continued, explaining how Matt and Malcolm's reputation for standing up against injustice had made them targets. Their defense of Caleb seemed to be the tipping point. Moving to the living room, Ms. Carter detailed the twins' history of advocacy. They've always protected others, she explained. Last semester, they exposed a cheating ring that involved several popular athletes. Before that, they stood up for a freshman being harassed. She pulled out her phone, showing Langley photos of vandalized lockers. The twins' names were spray-painted across them, accompanied by threatening messages. The online harassment has gotten worse too, she added. Someone created fake social media accounts to intimidate them. Langley leaned forward, his police instincts kicking in as he began connecting patterns. The threats seemed organized, suggesting more than just random teenage bullying. These aren't isolated incidents, Ms. Carter pressed. I'm worried about their safety. The threats are becoming more direct, more personal. I'll open an investigation immediately, Langley assured her, already reaching for his notepad. We'll take this seriously. Later that day, in his office, Langley created a new case file. He carefully documented everything Ms. Carter had shared, organizing the information methodically. His hand hesitated over the keyboard as he typed up his initial report, the weight of responsibility settling heavily on his shoulders. Langley sat at his desk, surrounded by stacks of printed social media posts and witness statements. His computer screen displayed a complex web of connections he'd mapped out over the past week. The threats against Matt and Malcolm all pointed to a group of students from Westwood Heights, the affluent section of town where the Prescott family held considerable sway. As he dug deeper, a disturbing pattern emerged. Similar incidents of harassment and bullying had been reported over the past 2 years, all involving the same core group of teenagers. Each complaint had mysteriously disappeared from the system or been marked as resolved without investigation. In the precinct's break room, Langley approached Officer Martinez, a veteran who'd handled several of the previous cases. "Why weren't these incidents properly investigated?" Langley asked, spreading the files across the break room table. Martinez shifted uncomfortably. "Look, Thomas, you're new to this beat. The Prescotts, they have connections. Their donations built half the community center." Back at his desk, Langley pulled up more records. Every case involving the Prescott teens had been quietly buried. Reports of vandalism, cyberbullying, even physical intimidation, all dismissed with minimal investigation. "You're poking a hornet's nest," Officer Chen warned, stopping by Langley's desk. "Last officer who tried to pursue something against that family got transferred to traffic duty in the next county." Langley discovered at least 5 separate incidents where the Prescott teenagers had targeted other students. Each time, their family's influence had shielded them from consequences. The pattern was clear. Money and power had created a protective bubble around these young troublemakers. In the evening, as the precinct emptied, Langley remained at his desk. The case file lay open before him, filled with evidence of not just the threats against the twins, but years of unchecked harassment enabled by systemic corruption. His computer screen glowed with dozens of testimonies from students who'd faced similar intimidation. The weight of the badge on his chest felt heavier than ever as he stared at the mounting evidence. The choice before him was clear: maintain the status quo or stand up against a system that protected the privileged at the expense of justice. The evening sun cast long shadows across the Taylor family's modest front yard as Langley's patrol car pulled up to the curb. Caleb fidgeted nervously in the passenger seat, clutching his backpack. The house was well maintained despite its age, with neat flower beds and a small vegetable garden visible from the driveway. Mrs. Taylor answered their knock with a guarded expression. Her eyes narrowed slightly at the sight of Langley in his uniform, though she softened when she noticed Caleb standing beside him. "Mrs. Taylor," Langley began, his voice steady but gentle, "I need to speak with you and your sons about a serious matter." She hesitated before stepping aside to let them in. Matt and Malcolm sat at the kitchen table, their homework spread before them. Both straightened as Langley entered, their faces carefully neutral. "We've uncovered some threats against Matt and Malcolm," Langley explained, keeping his distance to respect their space. "Anonymous messages, some vandalism at school. I believe they're being targeted because they stood up to bullies." Mrs. Taylor's expression hardened. "And why should we trust your concern now, Officer Langley?" The tension in the room grew thick enough to cut with a knife. But before Langley could respond, Caleb stepped forward, his voice quiet but clear. "Matt and Malcolm are heroes," he said, looking directly at the twins. "They helped me when nobody else would. They didn't care that my dad's a police officer or that I stutter sometimes. They just helped because it was right." The twins exchanged surprised glances as Caleb continued. "I used to hide from those bullies," he admitted. "But after seeing how brave Matt and Malcolm were, I started standing up for myself. Yesterday, when those same guys tried to pick on a younger kid, I told them to stop, and they did." Malcolm's usually stern expression softened slightly. Matt leaned forward, studying Caleb with newfound interest. "You did that?" Matt asked quietly. Caleb nodded. "Because of you guys. You showed me how." Mrs. Taylor's shoulders relaxed slightly as she watched the interaction. Langley remained silent, letting his son's words bridge the gap he couldn't cross alone. "The threats are serious," Langley added gently. "I want to help protect you boys, if you'll let me." The twins shared another look, having one of those silent conversations that only twins seemed capable of. Finally, Malcolm spoke. "Tell us what you know," he said. As Langley and Caleb prepared to leave later, they stood on the front porch under the warm porch light. Matt and Malcolm stood in the doorway, their expressions still cautious, but noticeably less guarded than before. Langley gave them a small nod, which they returned after a moment's hesitation. Langley's patrol car rolled to a stop in front of the Adams residence, its polished stone facade and manicured lawn reflecting wealth and privilege. His knuckles whitened on the steering wheel as he gathered his thoughts, knowing the confrontation ahead wouldn't be easy. The doorbell's chime echoed through the house, followed by measured footsteps. Mr. Adams opened the door, his initial look of mild interest morphing into thinly veiled disdain as Langley introduced himself. "I'm here about your boys," Langley stated firmly. "We need to discuss their behavior toward other students, including my son Caleb." Mr. Adams leaned against the doorframe, arms crossed. "Is that so?" he drawled, his tone dripping with condescension. "The harassment needs to stop," Langley continued. "The threats and bullying have gone too far." "Boys will be boys, officer," Mr. Adams replied with a dismissive wave. "Perhaps your son needs to toughen up a bit." Mrs. Adams appeared behind her husband, her designer outfit as pristine as her home. "What seems to be the problem here?" "Your children have been making threats," Langley explained, maintaining his composure. "We have evidence, including security footage and witness statements." "Evidence?" Mrs. Adams scoffed. "Aren't you overreacting? Children have disagreements all the time." Langley's jaw tightened. "This goes beyond disagreements. We're looking at potential legal consequences if this continues." The mention of legal action caused a slight crack in their facade. Mr. Adams straightened, his smug expression faltering. "Are you threatening us, officer?" Mrs. Adams demanded, but her voice carried a note of uncertainty. "I'm informing you of the situation," Langley replied evenly. "The evidence has been documented." Later that evening, Langley sat at his desk, methodically organizing statements and footage. Each piece of evidence built a stronger case, but he couldn't ignore the whispers around the precinct. His colleagues' sideways glances and hushed conversations suggested his persistence had caught unwanted attention from above. As he filed the last document, a memo from his superior requesting a meeting about his recent activities sat unopened on his desk. Langley strode into the precinct, his footsteps echoing through the familiar corridors. The case file under his arm felt heavier than usual, packed with evidence against the bullies. A few colleagues nodded in his direction, but their eyes quickly darted away, making his stomach tighten with unease. "Langley," the captain's voice cut through the morning bustle. "My office. Now." Inside the office, the captain's expression was grave as he slid a letter across the desk. Langley's fingers trembled slightly as he picked it up, his eyes scanning the words that made his blood run cold. "Official notice of suspension." "You've been accused of misconduct," the captain said, his voice low. "Excessive force and harassment of minors." Langley's mouth went dry. "That's ridiculous. These are false allegations. The Adams family—" "I know," the captain interrupted, raising a hand. "But the higher-ups want this handled quietly. You've stirred up trouble with some influential people, Tom." Langley pulled out his case file, spreading photos and witness statements across the desk. "Look at this evidence, the threats, the pattern of harassment." "My hands are tied," the captain said, not meeting his eyes. "Badge and gun, Tom, until this is resolved." With stiff movements, Langley unclipped his badge and removed his service weapon. Each item made a dull thud as he placed them on the desk, the sound feeling like a physical blow. That evening, Langley sat at his kitchen table, staring blankly at his coffee. Caleb approached quietly, pulling out a chair beside him. "Dad?" Caleb's voice was soft but steady. "You're not giving up, are you?" Langley looked at his son, seeing the same determination he'd witnessed in Matt and Malcolm's eyes. He shook his head slowly. "No," he said firmly. "This isn't just about clearing my name anymore. It's about doing what's right." In his car outside the precinct, Langley held his badge one final time, running his thumb over the familiar surface before placing it in the glove compartment. The metal felt cold against his fingers, a stark reminder of everything at stake. Langley sat at his dining room table, surrounded by case files spread across the wooden surface. His coffee had gone cold, forgotten as he scrutinized each document. The sharp ring of his phone cut through the silence. "I've heard about what's happening," Ms. Carter's voice was firm on the other end. "We can't let this slide." The next morning, Langley found himself in Ms. Carter's office at Westwood High. The familiar school corridors felt different now, charged with purpose. Ms. Carter wasn't alone. Matt and Malcolm sat in chairs by her desk, their expressions guarded but attentive. "These boys have seen firsthand what those bullies are capable of," Ms. Carter explained, gesturing to the twins. "They've agreed to share their experiences." Malcolm spoke first, his voice quiet but steady. "We've watched them target kids who couldn't defend themselves, the way they went after Caleb." He trailed off, exchanging a glance with his brother. Matt picked up where Malcolm left off. "It wasn't just teasing. They'd wait until no adults were around, corner kids between classes. We stepped in when we could, but they always found new targets." As they gathered more testimonies throughout the day, students and teachers came forward with their own accounts. Ms. Carter methodically documented each story, building a comprehensive picture of the bully's behavior pattern. That afternoon, Langley's phone rang again. A journalist from the local paper had caught wind of his suspension and the circumstances surrounding it. "This goes deeper than just bullying," the journalist said. "The public needs to know about the systemic issues at play. Your story, and those twins, could make a real difference." When Langley mentioned the article to Matt and Malcolm, they tensed visibly. "We don't want more attention," Malcolm said, shaking his head. "People already look at us differently," Matt added. But Caleb, who had tagged along with his father, stepped forward. His eyes were bright with conviction as he addressed the twins. "People need to know," he said earnestly. "What you did for me, others should hear about it." The twins exchanged a long look before Matt nodded slowly. "Okay," he said. "We'll do it." Langley gathered the thick folder of testimonies, tucking it carefully into his briefcase. As he walked through the school parking lot, the weight of the documents felt different now, less like a burden and more like hope. The journalist's article spread like wildfire across social media platforms. Within hours of its publication, NAR Justice for Langley and DAR's Stand Against Bias were trending locally. The piece painted a vivid picture of Langley's journey from his mishandling of the twins' detention to his current fight against systemic prejudice. Comments flooded the newspaper's website. "This is what real change looks like. Those twins are heroes. Time to hold the wealthy accountable." Back at the precinct, Langley's return was met with mixed reactions. Officer Jenkins clapped him on the shoulder, saying, "Good to have you back," while others averted their eyes or whispered behind closed doors. Langley kept his head high, focusing on organizing the mounting evidence against the bullies. "The article's getting attention," the journalist told Matt and Malcolm during their meeting at the school library. "People want to hear more of your story." Malcolm fidgeted with his sleeve. "What if it makes things worse?" "It already feels like everyone's watching us," Matt added, his voice low. The journalist leaned forward. "That's exactly why your voice matters. You've stood up for others. Now it's time to stand up for yourselves." The twins shared a look. Then Matt straightened in his chair. "Okay," he said. "Where do you want us to start?" Their interview was raw and honest. They spoke about defending Caleb, about the countless times they'd witnessed injustice, about the weight of being judged before being known. Malcolm described the fear that came with standing up to bullies, while Matt explained how their grandmother had taught them to face adversity with dignity. "We don't do it to be heroes," Malcolm said quietly. "We do it because someone has to." Caleb beamed with pride when he saw the twins quoted in the paper. "Dad, look," he exclaimed, pointing to their words. "They're so brave." Langley sat in his home office reading the follow-up article. Each word from the twins struck him deeply. Their courage, their resilience, their unwavering moral compass despite every obstacle. His eyes lingered on Malcolm's quote about standing up because someone had to. The words echoed his own journey, reminding him why this fight mattered so much. Caleb sat in the living room, his legs crossed on the couch as he faced his father. His eyes sparkled with enthusiasm, a stark contrast to his usual reserved demeanor. "Dad, I have an idea," he announced, his voice carrying a newfound confidence. Langley set down his coffee mug, giving his son his full attention. As Caleb outlined his plan for a neighborhood concert featuring the Taylor twins, his words tumbled out in excited bursts. He explained how Matt's piano skills and Malcolm's violin talents could bring people together, showing everyone the twins' true character. "They're amazing musicians, Dad," Caleb insisted. "If people could just see them perform, maybe they'd understand." Langley's brow furrowed with concern. "I don't know, son. After everything that's happened, it might draw unwanted attention." But Caleb wouldn't be deterred. "That's exactly why we need to do it. Please, Dad, at least let's ask them." The next day, Langley's patrol car pulled up to the Taylor residence. Caleb practically bounced out of the passenger seat, his enthusiasm infectious. When Matt opened the door, surprise flickered across his face at seeing them both. Inside, the twins listened intently as Caleb presented his idea. Malcolm shifted uncomfortably on the couch, while Matt remained perfectly still, his expression thoughtful. "A concert?" Malcolm asked quietly. "I don't know. People might not want to see us perform." "Or they might cause trouble," Matt added, his voice measured. Caleb leaned forward earnestly. "But that's why it's important. You can show everyone who you really are. Please?" The twins exchanged a long look, having one of their silent conversations. Finally, Matt turned back to Caleb. "Okay," he said softly. "We'll do it." Caleb immediately threw himself into the planning. He convinced Ms. Carter to provide the school auditorium, his enthusiasm winning her over completely. The journalist who had covered their story agreed to help promote the event, recognizing its potential impact. "We could set up refreshments in the lobby," Caleb explained to his father one evening, surrounded by hastily scribbled notes. "And maybe get local businesses to sponsor it?" The date was set for 3 weeks away. As Caleb proudly showed his father the preliminary flyer design, Langley felt a surge of pride. His son had transformed from a bullied, hesitant boy into someone who fought for what he believed in. In the Taylor household, the twins began their practice sessions with renewed purpose. The sound of Malcolm's violin and Matt's piano drifted through the neighborhood, a preview of what was to come. The school auditorium hummed with excitement as people filed in, filling nearly every seat. Caleb stood near the stage with his father, practically vibrating with nervous energy as he watched the crowd grow. His handmade programs, carefully designed on his computer, passed from hand to hand through the audience. "I can't believe how many people came," Caleb whispered to his father, his eyes wide with wonder. Backstage, Matt adjusted his tie while Malcolm tightened his bowstrings one last time. Their matching dark suits made them look older, more polished than their usual casual attire. Through the curtain, they could hear the growing murmur of voices. When the lights dimmed, a hush fell over the crowd. Matt and Malcolm stepped onto the stage, their footsteps echoing in the silence. Matt settled at the grand piano while Malcolm positioned his violin. With a subtle nod between them, they began to play. The first notes floated through the air, a classical piece that started softly but built in intensity. Their timing was perfect, each brother anticipating the other's movements with practiced ease. The music swelled, filling every corner of the auditorium. Between pieces, Matt spoke about their grandmother who raised them, his voice steady and clear. Malcolm shared a story about their first instruments, drawing gentle laughter from the crowd. When they described their recent experiences, standing up against bullies and finding unexpected allies, the audience listened in rapt attention. Their original composition, a piece they'd written about hope and resilience, brought tears to many eyes. The melody spoke of struggle but also of triumph, the violin and piano weaving together in perfect harmony. In the front row, Langley felt his eyes growing wet. He watched as the same community that had once viewed the twins with suspicion now sat captivated by their talent and courage. Ms. Carter, seated nearby, dabbed at her eyes with a tissue. The journalist who had helped share their story scribbled notes furiously, though his own eyes shone with emotion. When Matt and Malcolm played their final note, the silence lasted only a moment before the audience erupted in thunderous applause. People rose to their feet, their cheers echoing off the walls. The twins stood side by side, accepting the ovation with graceful nods and small smiles. Langley caught their eye from his seat, and in that moment something passed between them, an understanding that transcended words. The boys who had once been wrongly accused now stood as beacons of change, their music breaking down barriers that had seemed insurmountable just weeks before. The applause continued as audience members approached the stage, eager to express their appreciation. The twins accepted each compliment with humility, their quiet strength touching everyone who spoke with them. The shattered glass crunched under Langley's boots as he approached the Taylor residence. The sight made his stomach turn. Crude words spray-painted across the white walls, broken windows like jagged teeth, and personal belongings strewn across the front lawn. Matt and Malcolm stood with their grandmother near the porch steps, their faces a mixture of anger and exhaustion. "I came as soon as I got the call," Langley said, pulling out his notebook. He documented each instance of damage while other officers photographed the scene. Mrs. Taylor, her hand trembling slightly, described hearing the crashes and shouts just minutes before. "We were practicing upstairs," Matt explained, his voice tight. "By the time we got down here, they were gone." Malcolm stayed quiet, staring at the remains of his violin case lying broken on the grass. The instrument itself had survived, but the case bore deep scratches from being thrown. After completing his initial report, Langley gathered the family in their kitchen, one of the few undamaged rooms. "I'm assigning extra patrols to your street," he assured them. "We'll find who did this." "Maybe we should stop," Malcolm said suddenly, breaking his silence. "The concert, standing up to them. It's only making things worse." Matt turned to his brother, surprise flickering across his face. "You can't mean that." "Look what they did to our home," Malcolm gestured toward the window. "What if next time?" "There won't be a next time," Langley interrupted firmly. "Your courage has inspired people. That's why they're lashing out. Because you're making a difference." Caleb, who had arrived with his father, stepped forward. "You guys are heroes," he said earnestly. "When you stood up for me, it showed me I could be brave too. Please don't give up." Mrs. Taylor wrapped an arm around each of her grandsons. "Your parents would be so proud of the young men you've become," she said softly. "Don't let fear steal your voice." The twins exchanged a long look, years of unspoken understanding passing between them. Finally, Matt nodded. "We're not giving up," he said, and Malcolm's shoulders straightened with renewed resolve. Langley finished taking statements and coordinating with the other officers. As he prepared to leave, he placed a reassuring hand on each twin's shoulder. "We're in this together now," he said firmly. "Whatever comes next, you're not facing it alone." He climbed into his patrol car, his determination hardening as he looked back at the vandalized house. The sight of the damage stirred something deep within him, a fierce protectiveness he hadn't expected to feel for these boys who had once been strangers. The late-night message buzzed on Langley's phone, its anonymous nature making him uneasy. "Meet me at the diner tomorrow. I have something you'll want to see." He studied the unknown number, weighing the risks against his desperate need for a breakthrough. The next morning, Langley sat in Joe's diner nursing a lukewarm coffee. The bell above the door chimed, and Officer Sarah Martinez, a veteran from his precinct, slid into the booth across from him. Her eyes darted around the nearly empty restaurant before she spoke. "You didn't hear this from me," she whispered, sliding a thick manila envelope across the sticky table. "But I couldn't stay quiet anymore. Not after seeing what you're trying to do for those boys." Langley opened the envelope carefully, his eyes widening as he examined its contents. Bank statements showed regular payments from the Adams family to local officials. Email threads revealed coordinated efforts to suppress complaints about their children's behavior. Witness statements had been buried, marked as resolved without investigation. "How did you get these?" Langley asked, his voice barely above a whisper. I process a lot of paperwork, Martinez replied. Things start to form patterns when you pay attention. What you're doing, standing up to them, it gave me the courage to come forward. Langley spent the next hour methodically reviewing each document. The evidence painted a clear picture of systemic corruption, with the wealthy families using their influence to shield their children from consequences. He immediately called the journalist who had covered the twins' story. "I need to meet with you," he said. "This goes deeper than we thought." Next, he contacted Ms. Carter, knowing her influence in the community would be crucial for what came next. His final call was to the Taylor residence. "We're making progress," he told Matt and Malcolm. "Don't lose hope. We've got solid evidence now." As he gathered the documents back into the envelope, Martinez had already slipped away unnoticed. Langley stood, tucking the file securely under his arm. The weight of the evidence felt substantial, matching the gravity of what it contained. He walked to his car, knowing this could change everything. The courtroom buzzed with tension as Langley settled into his seat beside the twins, their grandmother, and Caleb. Across the aisle, the bullies' families sat with their expensive lawyers, their designer suits and confident smirks speaking volumes about their privileged status. The prosecutor, a sharp-eyed woman in her 40s, strode to the center of the courtroom. She methodically laid out the evidence, manila folders filled with bank statements showing suspicious payments, email threads revealing coordinated cover-ups, and crystal-clear security footage of the vandalism at the Taylor home. "Your Honor," she began, her voice steady and clear, "what we have here is not just a case of teenage bullying. This is about systemic corruption, about wealthy families using their influence to shield their children from consequences." When Langley took the stand, he spoke with quiet authority about his own journey from prejudice to understanding. His voice cracked slightly as he described finding the Taylor home vandalized, the twins standing strong despite their fear. Caleb's testimony brought tears to many eyes. "They protected me when no one else would," he said, his young voice carrying through the hushed courtroom. "They didn't even know me, but they stood up to the bullies anyway." Ms. Carter's testimony proved particularly compelling. She stood tall at the witness stand, her years of educational experience lending weight to her words. "Matt and Malcolm Taylor represent the very best of our community," she declared. "They've faced discrimination and harassment, yet they consistently choose to help others, to stand up for what's right." When the twins took the stand, the courtroom fell silent. Malcolm spoke first, his usually quiet voice finding strength as he described years of enduring prejudice and harassment. Matt followed, detailing the escalating threats and the night their home was vandalized. The defense attorneys attempted to paint the twins as troublemakers, their questions aggressive and leading. "Isn't it true that you provoked these incidents?" one lawyer demanded. But the twins remained composed, their responses measured and honest. The journalist's investigative report proved devastating to the defense's case. Page after page of documented corruption unfolded before the jury, while the anonymous tipster's evidence provided irrefutable proof of the family's interference in previous investigations. The judge, a stern-faced woman with silver hair, repeatedly admonished the defense for their aggressive tactics. "Counsel," she warned during a particularly heated cross-examination, "this court will not tolerate attempts to intimidate witnesses." The jury listened intently, many taking notes as the evidence mounted. Several jurors nodded visibly during the twins' testimony, while others frowned deeply at the defense's attempts to discredit them. The media coverage of the trial sparked a remarkable transformation in Springvale. Neighbors who had previously kept their distance from the Taylor family now approached with heartfelt apologies and offers of support. Some brought home-cooked meals, while others helped repair the damage to the Taylor home, painting over the remnants of hateful graffiti with fresh, bright colors. At the precinct ceremony, Langley stood uncomfortably in his pressed uniform as the chief pinned a commendation medal to his chest. The gathered officers applauded, but Langley's eyes sought out Matt and Malcolm in the crowd. Their presence, along with Caleb's beaming face, meant more to him than any official recognition. "Officer Langley demonstrated extraordinary courage and dedication to justice," the chief announced. "His actions remind us of our true duty to protect and serve all members of our community." Later that week, the Taylor home buzzed with the warmth of celebration. string lights twinkled in the backyard, and the aroma of Mrs. Taylor's cooking filled the air. Malcolm played soft melodies on his violin, while Matt accompanied him on the piano, their music creating a peaceful atmosphere that seemed to wash away the tension of the past months. Caleb moved easily between the guests, his previous shyness replaced by confident joy. He had formed a special bond with the twins, who treated him like a younger brother. As evening settled in, Matt found Langley on the porch away from the main celebration. They stood in comfortable silence for a moment, watching the fireflies dance in the growing darkness. "You know," Matt said quietly, "when you first stopped us that day, I never thought we'd end up here." Langley nodded, understanding the weight of those words. "Neither did I, but you taught me what courage really looks like, standing up for what's right, even when it seems like the whole world is against you." The conversation paused as they heard laughter from inside. Malcolm was teaching Caleb some basic violin positions, the boy's face scrunched in concentration. Mrs. Taylor appeared with plates of dessert, her eyes bright with unshed tears of joy. "You're always welcome here," she told Langley, squeezing his arm gently before returning inside. The community center buzzed with energy as Langley settled into his seat beside Ms. Carter. The room was filled with local leaders, educators, and concerned citizens, all gathered to discuss the new initiative, Bridging the Divide. Sunlight streamed through tall windows, illuminating the hopeful faces of those assembled. Ms. Carter stood at the podium, her voice clear and passionate as she outlined the program's goals. "We need to create spaces where understanding can grow," she explained, "where barriers can be broken down through honest dialogue and shared experiences." When she invited Matt and Malcolm to become program ambassadors, the twins exchanged uncertain glances. Malcolm fidgeted with his sleeve while Matt studied the faces in the room. "Your story has power," Langley encouraged softly. "Think of how many others you could help." After a thoughtful pause, Matt spoke for both of them. "We'll do it," he said. "If our experience can make a difference, we want to be part of that change." The initiative took shape quickly. Workshops filled the community center's calendar, and school assemblies were scheduled throughout the district. The twin story became a cornerstone of the program, their journey from targets of prejudice to advocates for change resonating deeply with audiences. Caleb threw himself into the organizing efforts with enthusiasm, helping to set up events and sharing his own story. His voice, young but steady, carried special weight when he described how witnessing the twins' courage had changed his perspective. During one particularly powerful forum, Langley stood before a packed audience, his hands slightly trembling as he spoke about his past biases. "I was wrong," he admitted, his voice thick with emotion. "I let assumptions cloud my judgment, and in doing so, I nearly caused irreparable harm." The room fell silent as he described his journey from that first confrontation with the twins to his current role in promoting understanding. His honesty touched something in the audience. Heads nodded in recognition, and several people wiped away tears. At the initiative's first major event, Matt and Malcolm took the stage together. Their presence commanded attention, their words carrying the weight of hard-won wisdom. As they finished speaking, the audience rose as one, applause thundering through the room. Langley watched from the side, his chest swelling with pride as he witnessed the impact of their message. The morning sun streamed through Langley's kitchen window, casting warm patterns across the counter as he sipped his coffee. The aroma mingled with the melodic sound of piano keys drifting from the living room, where Caleb and Matt were practicing their duet. The notes flowed smoothly, punctuated occasionally by Malcolm's gentle guidance on stage presence. "Keep your shoulders back," Malcolm advised Caleb. "Remember to breathe between phrases." Langley leaned against the kitchen doorframe, watching the scene unfold. Matt's fingers moved confidently across the keys while Caleb followed along, his face scrunched in concentration. Malcolm stood nearby, demonstrating proper posture with the patience of a seasoned performer. The sight stirred memories in Langley's mind, that tense morning months ago when he'd first encountered the twins. His assumptions had nearly destroyed lives that day. The weight of his badge had felt different then, heavy with authority rather than responsibility. Now, watching the easy friendship between his son and the Taylor twins, Langley felt the full measure of how far they'd all come. Caleb had transformed from a shy, bullied child into someone who stood tall and spoke with conviction. The twins had become more than just neighbors or friends. They were family. Their influence had reached beyond music lessons, teaching Caleb about courage, integrity, and standing up for what was right. The piano music swelled, filling the house with harmony. Langley smiled, recognizing the piece as one the twins had performed at their community concert. That event had marked a turning point for everyone, breaking down barriers and building bridges that seemed impossible before. Pride swelled in Langley's chest as he watched Caleb master a particularly challenging passage. His son's fingers moved more confidently now, guided by Matt's patient instruction. Malcolm's coaching had helped Caleb overcome his stage fright, replacing nervous habits with proper performance techniques. As the final notes of the duet resonated through the room, Langley stepped forward, applauding with genuine pride. Caleb's face lit up with a bright grin, while Matt and Malcolm shared a knowing glance. In that moment, surrounded by music and friendship, Langley felt the completeness of a life renewed. If you enjoyed the story of Matt and Malcolm, I handpicked this next story that you will enjoy. Please don't miss this one. Click here to watch it.